The title of today's message is Who is Examining You? When I say that, who is examining you? The word that we'll be looking at here has this connotation not only examine, but to judge, to test, to assay, to try. Again, we'll go over some of these words, I'll point them out. But the word that I'm talking about is peirazo, P-E-I-R-A-Z-O. Of course, that's as close as you're going to get from the Greek. Peirazo. It means to try whether a thing can be done, to attempt, to endeavor, to try, make trial of, test for the purpose of ascertaining quantity, what he thinks or how he'll behave himself in a good sense. It also has a bad connotation to it as well. It means, in a bad sense, to test one maliciously or craftily, sort of like tempting. To try or test one's faith, virtue, character by enticement to sin. Okay, it's to solicit somebody to sin, to tempt them, as in what the devil would do. So the point is, again, then, who is looking at you this way? And I think some of us often have or can be conscientious about this. And it comes out when they say, well, who are you to judge me? Or even if somebody doesn't say something, even they give you a look, and it might be a knowing look, and you're going, you know, you feel, oh, you're evaluating me. You're looking at me in a certain way. You know, the question then is, well, who is doing that? And what should be our response? How is it that we should be looking at these things? Because the simple fact of the matter is that we are being examined. And we're going to go over five categories of who is examining us. So we're going to begin with the first one. And again, we've alluded to it already, but it's Satan. Satan is examining us. And we can throw his demons in there too, that whole evil spirit realm. And Satan is doing it all the time. Let's turn to Job 1. We'll read verses 7 through 11. But Satan, who is a spirit being who never tires, who is purpose-driven, is going to be examining each and every one of us to the fullest extent all the time. Job 1 and verse 7, we see this, that he's always looking for fault, right? So these first two categories that we'll be going through have a negative connotation. It's a negative connotation of an examination. But again, this is what he is doing to each and every one of us, specifically the church of God. Job chapter 1 and verse 7, and the Lord said to Satan, where do you come from? Knowing good and well. So Satan answered the Lord and said, from going to and fro on the earth, from walking back and forth on it. Again, this is what he did. This is all he has to do, right? This is his domain. And he has, like I said, this one purpose. And that is to destroy the plan of God, is to not allow the plan of God to succeed by causing his people, the one that God is working with, to fail. And then the Lord said to Satan, well, you know, in all this to and froing that you're doing, have you considered my servant Job, that there is none like him on the earth, a blameless and upright man? He was righteous, one who fears God and shuns evil. Have you considered him by chance? And so Satan answered the Lord and said, does Job fear God for nothing? Again, he knew who Job was. He had examined Job. And he's now, again, he's playing his games. He's trying to get God to allow him to do what he wants. In verse 10, have you not made a hedge around him? Of course. You know, he fears you and everything. He's all good and everything like that because you don't let me at him. And why is Satan saying that? Because Satan is going to try anything and everything possible to, through his examination, to thwart each and every person's walk. He wants to, again, find that kink in your armor and exploit it. And he says, and around his household, and continuing the verse, around his household, around all that he has on every side, he's put this hedge. You have blessed the work of his hands. Right? And again, there's a correlation between why he blessed him, though. But verse 11, he says, but now, stretch out your hand and touch all that he has, and surely he will curse you to your face. This is what Satan is trying to do. For the purpose of, you know, for his purpose, he is looking at each and every one of us under a microscope. And he is going to tempt each and every one. We see that in Matthew 4, verse 3, where it's the temptation of Christ. It says, now when the tempter, okay, Matthew 4, verse 3, the tempter, this word for tempt is the same word, parazo, right? That's what it's calling, and of course, obviously, this is in the negative connotation. This tester, this tempter, this trier, he came to him, to Christ, and he said, if you are the Son of God, command that these stones become bread. So he immediately starts trying to test Christ, to tempt him, to make him to sin. He saw, okay, he examined Christ, and what did he find? This is the first temptation, that Christ had been fasting for 40 days and 40 nights before he even began this temptation, right? And so here he was, he didn't have food. So here he is, he's trying to make Christ say, okay, here, let's go against what you should be doing, against what God wants you to do. And through his examination, he comes up with a very clever plan to try to cause Christ to sin. In Revelation 12, in verse 10, we see, again, you don't have to turn there. It's a, I think, kind of a memorization scripture, but it says that the devil is the accuser of the brethren. And he accuses us before God day and night. Again, this is his raison d'etre, his reason for being. Satan wants to, again, go and say, hey, so-and-so is doing this, so-and-so is doing that. How does he come to those conclusions? How does Satan come to that? It's because he has been looking at our lives, right? So as we walk around, okay, and this is, he's in the spirit realm, he still looks at us here in the physical realm, whether it's him or some of his minions, and they're taking notes. They're looking and say, oh, okay, so-and-so, they were doing this, and that was not in accordance with the Bible. And don't believe for a second that Satan does not know the Bible backwards and forwards. Of course he does. That's why, you know, he tried to tempt Christ. He knew what the Bible said. He even quotes the Bible. The Bible says that the demons believe, right, that there is a God. But they don't do what he says. But they believe that there's a God. So there's more to it than that. But here he is. He's taking notes. He's going around. And as you walk around and as you do everything that you're doing, you are being examined by Satan. And Satan only wants to do one thing, and that's to take advantage of those things. Luke 22, verses 31 to 34. Luke 22. Verses 31 to 34. And the Lord said, Simon, Simon, indeed, Satan has asked for you that he may sift you as wheat. And the connotation here, too, is that he's asking for the others as well. And he is and will be asking for us. And, you know, if somebody says, I'm going to sift you like wheat, I'm going, well, I'm not sure that that really scares me a lot. But in this connotation, whenever you look at this, you know, I'm thinking, say, from a secular point of view, Now, to me, this has one of the scariest connotations in all of the Bible, is that Satan wants to sift you as wheat. You know, what does that mean? You know, he's going to take this, and you know, typically when you go and you take a sieve and you're trying to sift wheat, you're kind of shaking it and you're trying to make sure that nothing falls, and you're trying to get the good stuff through the sieve, and the chaff, which you say we can make analogous to sin, you want that to stay away, or you want it to kind of blow away, and so you're kind of popping it up and letting the fan or the wind blow it away, and you're trying to obviously keep all the good, all the wheat, right? So what do you think Satan does when he tries to sift you like a sieve? Do you think he even cares? I mean, well, he only cares to the point that it's not just the good that's going through. I mean, can you imagine Satan with a sieve of you and just shaking it crazy, and you know, stuff's going here and stuff's still mixing up, and you know, you're getting the good with the bad, and hopefully, you know, he's trying to get more of the bad. You know, he wants to take you, and I don't even know that it does it justice to think of it, but when you look at it in connotation, it's a scary thing to sift you like wheat. That's what he wants to do. And you know, we'll look at the reverse of that here in a little bit, but he doesn't care. Satan is this agitator, right? And again, it takes a little agitation to separate sin from the good qualities that we're supposed to be exhibiting, the fruit of the Spirit, right? God's trying to, you know, sift that and trying to, you know, take out the bad. Satan, he's just going to go in there and he's just going to try to make the biggest mess of it possible and hopefully cause you to sin more and to fall short even more. Verse 32 says, "But I have prayed for you that your faith should not fail, and when you have returned, to strengthen your brethren." So again, Christ is praying for us. He is on our side. He's trying to help us in every which way possible. And also, you might make note of the fact that too, that Satan has had to ask for this. You know, like he did in Job, God had to give permission, and he puts this hedge and he puts these limits on Satan. But that does not stop Satan from analyzing you and taking all that list of sins up to God and saying, look, I told you so. These guys don't deserve what you have in plan and ready for them. But he said to him, "Lord, I am ready to go with you both to prison and to death." And then he said, "I tell you, Peter, the rooster shall not crow this day before you will deny three times that you know me." So here he is, he's being told that Satan is going to do this to you, that Satan's going to try to trip you up, that Satan wants you so badly. And yet, here we know what happens, right? That he did deny him. He couldn't even last. Again, that's, again, the power that Satan has when he comes at us, because we give him these things that are valid arguments that he brings before God. Ephesians 4, verses 26 and 27. Again, it says, "Be angry and do not sin." Do not sin. "Do not let the sun go down on your wrath, nor give place to the devil." So he says, do not be in this state of sinning. We can generalize it here. You know, it's not just being angry. It's doing anything. It's leaving ourselves open to sin, or having a sin that's, say, not taken care of. Because if we do have a sin like that, that's out in the open, what does it say in verse 27? That you will give place to the devil. You will give him an opportunity to do the things that he wants to do. And because he's sitting there and examining you, scrutinizing you, and sharpening the tip on his pencil and saying, "We're going to get all this stuff down. We're going to know exactly what it is. And look at this." You know, he's right, he's taking good notes as the sun goes down. And unless you correct that, then he's going to, you know, go before God with glee, say, look, look, look. And he will have a valid reason to do that because he has been examining you. Number two, we are examined by people in the world. Again, we know this. We should know this. I mean, we've come across this, that people are going to look at you and they're going to judge you. And they're going to examine you. And especially if it doesn't jive with their philosophy, they're going to be critical of you. And they're going to take notes. And the thing is, with the walk that we walk, it is, in many respects, considerably different, just starting with the day that we're meeting on. Right? So if they say, oh, you keep the Sabbath, but then you go off and you work on the Sabbath, or you go off and do your own pleasures on the Sabbath, and they see that your keeping of the Sabbath is no different than anybody else's, what are they going to do? They're going to say, uh-huh, I see. Really, you're a Sabbath Christian. You're not even that, really. You know, the Sabbath Christian is the one who actually only does their Christianity on the Sabbath. You're not even doing that. You know, we look around even at politics today. You know, there's a party of people right now that they have more conservative, more, you know, Christian-based values. I won't call them complete Christians, but the other side looks at them and says, oh, you fell short in this area. And they will just run them through the ringers. I mean, they will vilify them. They're on the 5 o'clock news. Now it's the internet. It's gone viral. They're saying all kinds of things about them, even when they don't believe those things. Right? So they are scrutinizing the people of God, anybody who says that they are a Christian, or is going to actually be examined by the world. And this is a category that we need to be cognizant of. And it was no different. It has been no different because, as we know, you know, behind all the sin is Satan. So it's not surprising that he's this motivator of people in the world to examine us to this negative, in this negative way. Matthew 22, verses 15 through 22. We see again, 2,000 years ago, it was no different. That the people in the world were judging Christ. They were examining him. They were trying to cause him to slip up based on what they knew, what they thought they knew about him, and with how they were going to try to catch him, because they thought, oh, we see holes and flaws in his Christianity. Matthew 22 and verse 15. Then the Pharisees went and plotted how they might entangle him in his talk. All right, so they're looking, they're testing. They're going, okay, he said such and such. All right, so let's examine that and say, okay, how can we tear that apart? Because that's not what we believe. And they sent to him, Christ, their disciples with the Herodians, saying, teacher, we know that you are true. Again, they're buttering him up and, you know, this false flattery, because they did not believe that. And teach the way of God in truth. Nor do you care about anyone. You're not a respecter of persons in that way. For you do not regard the person of men. Tell us therefore, O great one, O knowledgeable one. You know, and you can see that kind of attitude that they're having here. What do you think? Is it lawful to pay taxes to Caesar or not? Because the Romans had subjugated the Jews at this time. And the Jews were living under, as it were, just a governor in the region. And so they had to be subject to the authorities, which, again, you don't want some invading force to be dictating to you, to take away from your freedoms, to tell you what to do. Nobody wants that, right? The Jews at this time didn't want that. But now, here's a great way to get Christ in trouble, right? We're going to get him. If he says this, then we'll have him this way. If he says this, then we'll have him that way. And they had thought this through to the point where they're going, you know, they're purposefully, you know, through this examination, trying to find fault with him. Verse 18, But Jesus perceived the wickedness and said, "Why do you test me, you hypocrites?" And that word there for test is pirazo. So they had examined him, and they were trying him to this negative way to cause him to fail. And he says, "Show me the tax money." So they brought him a denarius, and he said to them, "Whose image and inscription is this?" And they said to him, "Caesar's." And he said to them, "Render therefore to Caesar the things that are Caesar's, and to God the thing that are God." And when they heard these words, they marveled and left him and went their way. So they were hoping that they could find fault. And again, this is what the world will do when they look at us. When they look at the things that we say we are, and they'll look at the things that we do, and they're going to say, do those things match up? Can we find fault? And there's going to be a time coming for sure when they're going to even try more so in this way. All right, this is not the things that we come against right now, and this is what we were saying in some of the precursory comments, was that the things that we have to go through right now are not that devastating. They're not that tough. They're not that bad. Now, there's a time coming when it will become that bad. And we might touch on that just a little bit later. But it was not this bad as it was here. Again, these guys were trying to find fault with him, right? To the point that they were trying to kill him so they couldn't eventually find anything. So they had to make up stuff. But nonetheless, they were constantly examining him. Category number three, God. Now we're moving more into the positive aspect of being examined. Amos 9, verses 8 and 9. I threw this one in by way of contrast. Amos 9, verses 8 through 9. To show how God is sifting. And there's a difference, and this just hopefully will help, you know, seal the other in your mind. Even if you just kind of store it in that category that's like sifting like wheat, that's really bad. You know, in the way that Satan does it, we still need to see the way that God does it. And the care and the concern that he takes when he does it. Amos 9. Verses 8 through 9. Behold, the eyes of the Lord God are on the sinful kingdom, and I will destroy it from the face of the earth. Yet I will not utterly destroy the house of Jacob, says the Lord. For surely I will command and will sift the house of Israel among all nations, as grain is sifted in a sieve. Yet not the smallest grain shall fall to the ground. You know, I had the opportunity at work this week to kind of do something similar. I had this one precious metal that I wanted to save, and I had this a few little junky things in it that's like, okay, when I bring this metal and I want to cash it in, and they see the junk in it, again, the mind automatically goes to say, oh, look how bad this is. There's probably a lot more of this in there, wherever that came from, the stuff I'm seeing. And it really, at the very end, wasn't that much. But it had this glaring effect that when you looked at it, your eyes were immediately drawn to it that, well, it's not just this one precious metal. It's all this other kind of junk in it. So I grabbed this one little, I went around looking for a little cage or something that I had that might be just perfect, and it was a little sieve, as it were, and I poured this in there, and I was able to kind of shake it and bounce it. And of course, how am I going to shake it and bounce it while I have this precious metal in there? I'm trying to keep it, right? I want to save all the good stuff, and I want to get rid of the bad stuff. And so I was careful, and I moved it around gently, because, you know, I don't want to throw it off and go on the floor and then have to try to sweep it up and get more dirt in it. So I'm being very, very careful, and I'm trying to save all this stuff. And then when I get to just the junk, I take all the junk back and I carefully move it over so that none of it falls in with the good stuff. You know, it's very much that same way that God is trying to work with us. The assaying aspect of this, I think I mentioned that in the beginning. To assay like a say gold, is to go through the gold and look at it and say, okay, how pure is this gold? Right? And typically, you know, gold is fired, you know, and you get rid of the impurities through this, and you can assay it with fire. And what happens is that the gold becomes more pure. Again, the last thing you want to see is, you know, the gold with a bit of junk in it, okay, because all of a sudden it's not pure. And this is the way that, of course, that God and everybody is looking at us, right? They look at us and go, okay, well, I see certain things, but man, that one sin that I see is sure is glaring. And it's like, I'm almost distracted. I almost can't even see the other stuff when I look at this. And this is what God wants us to do in this, okay? He examines us and he sees those things that are probably even more glaring to him. And what he wants to do is to examine that and show us and to try to take it out. He wants us to take it out. He doesn't want other people to see and to give cause to them, a reason for them to be able to say, oh, look at that one thing that wasn't sifted properly. That is still there amongst all the rest of the good stuff. So God has a process by which he is doing this and examining us. Let's look at that in Hebrews 11, the faith chapter. We'll read 30 to 40. Yeah, 30 verses 30 to 40. And as we go through this, notice what God has done with his faithful. He examines them and he says, okay, this is what you need to do. This is what you need to do so that you can become even more faithful. Hebrews 11 verse 30. By faith, the walls of Jericho fell down after they encircled for 7 days. Again, there was an action that was required there. By faith, the harlot Rahab did not perish with those who did not believe when she received the spies with peace. And what more shall I say? For the time would fail me to tell of Gideon and Barak and Samson and Jephthah, also of David and Samuel and the prophet, who through faith subdued kingdoms, worked righteousness. Okay, there were works that they did. Obtained promises, stopped the mouths of lions, quenched the violence of fire, escaped the edge of the sword, out of weakness were made strong, became valiant in battle, turned to flight the armies of the aliens. Women received their dead raised to life again, and others were tortured, not accepting deliverance, that they might obtain a better resurrection. I mean, are we, you know, to that point? Are we to that degree where when God says, okay, we need to try you, we need to examine you, okay, and we're going to go all the way to this extent, right, that you're unwilling to, in the hands of your captors, to admit anything just so it means that you can save your physical life, anything wrong, right, that the things that they're saying, okay, we want you to deny the Sabbath. And they go, nope. And he said, okay, we're going to torture you, we're going to kill you if you don't say, yeah, yes, I need to deny the Sabbath. And they said, no, we are not going to do that. And so they're trying to, again, the world is still trying to figure out a way to make you wrong. And what is our perspective? We're looking forward into the future for this better way, this resurrection. Still others had a trial of mockings and scourgings, yes, and of chains of imprisonment. They were stoned, they were sawn in two, which I can't even imagine, were tempted. Okay, this word here, tempted, is the same word, parazo. Okay, they were examined, they were tested, they were tried. These are the things that God allowed in this case. Okay, God said, okay, I'm going to test you here. Okay, and God, here's the difference, God tests us hoping that we will succeed. Satan and the world tempts us hoping that we will fail. Right? So again, we've said that before, but it's something to keep in mind as to why God examines us versus why the world and Satan do. And here we have in the faith chapter that God allowed them to be examined to this point. And they were slain with the sword. They wandered about in sheepskins and goatskins, being destitute, afflicted, and tormented. What of us, you know, who of us have done that? Okay? I don't think he means sheepskins and goatskins in a good way. Being destitute, afflicted, tormented. And he goes, of whom the world was not worthy. They wandered in deserts and mountains and dens and caves of the earth. You know, who among us can say that? None of us to this degree. And we might have our little hardship, our little trial. But in this great and blessed nation that God gave to us because of promises to Abraham, we don't have to suffer these types of things. Never to that extent. And all these have obtained a good testimony through faith, did not receive the promise. Again, you know, we go through these things, and God might not save you right at this point in time. He might allow you to go through this because of the examination that he did, saying, this is what you need to go through to build that faith. To build the faith that I require, the faith that I need, the faith that I know that you can exhibit and show and grow. God having provided something better for us, that they should not be made perfect apart from us. Again, these, you know, the writer of Hebrews is saying this about in a past context about the present. Said, okay, the same thing is true for us at the time that this was written. And again, the same thing is true for us today, now, about those who went before us and the necessity for us to go through whatever it is that God, when he examines us, finds that we need. You know, God does these things because he loves us. Hebrews 12, verse 6. We just turn over a chapter, or maybe not even have to turn at all. It says, for whom the Lord loves, he chastens. He scourges every son whom he receives. We have this parent-child relationship with God the Father. We are his sons and daughters. He wants the best for us. When he examines us and he sees that we're wanting, that we have need, specifically of growth, he corrects us. He says, okay, here's the way, walk you in it. You know, it's the train up a child in the way that he should go, and he will not soon depart from it. That's what God is doing with the examination that he has done of us. You know, 1 Peter 4:17 says, now is the time for judgment on the house of God. So he's doing that for our good. And it is upon us right now. So we need to believe that that is going on, that that is indeed happening. 1 Corinthians 10, verse 13, we see a little bit of how he does this. 1 Corinthians 10 and verse 13. Corinthians 10:13, no temptation, all right? So this is a form of the word parazo. It's parazomus, all right? It just means the same thing, just a form of this word, examine. So this testing, this trying, there's no form of it that has overtaken you except such as common to man. So the things you're going through, it has happened to all other men as well. But God is faithful, who will not allow you to be examined, to be tested, to tried, proved, beyond what you are able. So again, this we can take solace in. This we can be assured of. So that with the temptation, okay, again, the word examine, prove, paradzo, will also make the way of escape that you may be able to bear it. So when God goes through it, and when he examines us, when he chastens us, when he tries and tests us, hoping that we're going to pass, he always knows that we can make it through this. When it is of God, he is not going to do it beyond what we can bear. All right, so whenever we look at these things, and again, we're talking about perspective, talking about what it is that has happened to others, what happens to others right now, what has happened to others in the past, what happened to others in Hebrews 11, in the faith chapter, that you can do it. You can accomplish it. It will not be too much. Okay, it's not going to seem pleasant at the time, but it's going to bear good fruit in the end, because God knows what he's doing when he examines us. Category number four, people in the church. All right, so we had Satan and people in the world. Now we have God and people in the church. Okay, this is a positive category. We are to judge, we are to examine others, and we are to judge rightly. 1 Corinthians 5, verse 12. Again, the first thing that comes to most people's mind, we've addressed this before, and I'll try not to belabor this point too much, because we've given a whole sermon on the fact that we are to judge. It's called Thou Shalt Judge. You can find it on the website if you like. But 1 Corinthians 5, verse 12 shows that, again, people don't read the whole context of the scripture that says, do not judge, you know, thou shalt not judge. They stop right there and do not see that, yes, we are. We're supposed to do it correctly. And we're supposed to be in the right frame of mind as well. But 1 Corinthians 5 and verse 12 says, for what have I to do with judging those who are on the outside? Do you not judge those who are on the inside? Paul saying, okay, the people in the world, they're going about their business. I said, they're not going to be judged. They're not even going to be regulated by the word of God, by the principles, by every word of God, you know, Matthew 4:4. That's in the Bible. They don't submit to that. I said, you know, I'm not judging them now. And plus, as we already said, judgment's not on them per se. It's on the household of God. But he also says, rhetorically, do you not judge those who are in the inside? Yes, of course you do, he's saying. But those who are outside, God judges. Therefore, put away from yourselves the evil person. Again, God's judging each one in their way and in their time. All right, and now, again, we have a different judgment on us than the world does, but the world will then have a judgment on them later. So therefore, put away from yourselves the evil person. Chapter 6, verse 1, the continuation. Dare any of you, having a matter against another, go to law before the unrighteous, not before saints? It says, what are you thinking about bringing this to the worldly courts? So you need to bring it to, you know, the people in the church. They're the ones to judge you correctly and rightly. Do you not know that the saints will judge the world? And if the world will be judged by you, are you unworthy to judge the smallest matters, like what's going on here in your congregation? Of course you can judge those, and you should judge those. You know, judge not is not authority or license to say, oh, I'm going to just turn a blind eye to somebody else's sin because, oh, I'm not supposed to judge. No, it's not what he's saying. Do you not know that you will judge angels? How much more things that pertain to this life? I mean, that's a greater responsibility to judge angels. So of course you should be able to judge matters rightly in this life. You should know what the law says, the law of God. Right? And again, this is under the category of people in the church judging. If then you have judgments concerning things pertaining to this life, do you appoint those who are least esteemed by the church to judge? Again, setting a criteria here. I say this to your shame. It is so that there is not a wise man among you, not even one, who will be able to judge between his brethren. I mean, it's shameful if you can't do that. But brother goes to law against brother, and that before the worldly system, before unbelievers. Now, therefore, it is already an utter failure for you that you go to law against one another. Why do you not rather accept wrong? Why do you not rather let yourselves be cheated? So again, he's saying that, again, there is a Christian walk, a Christian way of doing things that even if it came to the point of, like, it couldn't be resolved, shouldn't you be the bigger person in this case? Now, the point here that we're saying is that in the church, we all know what the rules are. I mean, we're coming to grips with more and more of the way that God wants us to be. And when you see someone not doing that way, you automatically, I mean, it's a natural reaction to say that's wrong. Okay, if you're wondering about whether that's true or not, ask your kids. Or you probably don't even have to ask your kids. They will tell you. They're going, wait a second. You know, because kids, you know, are, how you say, innocent or unencumbered by so many of these things that perhaps we have going through our minds. They'll just kind of say, wait a second. I thought that this is the case, or I thought that was the case. And this is why, you know, being a good example to your child is probably the number one way to raise a child. You try to think, okay, how do I make sure that they do this? How do I make sure that they do that? How do I teach them and train them in all these things? Well, you do it. If you do it and you set the good example, then they will do it. Okay, or they'll be more likely to do it. At least they won't see the hypocrisy, because they will be judging. They will be looking at you and they'll be seeing, okay, they say this, but they don't do this. So my point is that one way or the other, people will judge you. Now, whether they act on it or say something might be another story, but they will be judging you, and they should in this respect, if you have care and concern and love for your brother. James 5, verses 19 and 20. You know, we're to judge. We are to, again, need to be careful when we do this, right? It needs to be within our purview, right? So something that we should be saying something to somebody about. James 5, 19 and 20. But we also need to choose our battles carefully and wisely. And we do not condemn. Okay, there's a difference between judging and condemning. Again, we've talked about that as well. But James 5, verses 19 and 20 says, brethren, if anyone among you wanders from the truth and someone turns him back, all right, so what does that mean? All right, you had to make the judgment, right? That somebody has begun to err. So you examine them, you found them wanting, right? Because they, again, not by our rules, but the truth, which is God's. And you go and say, hey, I think you need to turn around this way. I think you need to repent, right? What is repenting? Turning 180 degrees, going the opposite direction of the wrong way and going the right way. And verse 20, let him know that he who turns a sinner from the error of his way will save a soul from death and cover a multitude of sins. This is loving the brethren, right? To examine them, to look at them. Again, I'm not saying, hey, go and look at the speck in your brother's eye all the time when you have a beam in yours, right? It's to, when these things come up, it's not your full-time job to go around and criticize and critique everybody, because we have enough to do with ourselves. But we, again, when something gets to that point and it's so obvious and it's necessary, it is an act of love by your examination of them to help them walk a better path. Category number 5. Who is the last person to be judging you. And the last category, right, it's us, it's we, it's you and me. We are to be judging ourselves, examining ourselves, right? We need to do this in order that other people don't have to, all right? We cannot be such a complete mess that everything in our lives is just, you know, somebody needs to be telling us everything, right? We need to be looking at ourselves and saying, okay, this, that, and the other thing is something I need to be working. And of course, we need to be very honest and truthful about it, because I think that we can go and we'll say, well, I'm not really that way. In fact, I'm good. You know, kind of like Job, I'm got nothing to work on. I got no problems, right? Yet they had to dedicate 42 chapters to him, right? Because of his self-righteousness. He didn't think he was self-righteous, okay? But God gave him some hard questions that he wasn't able to answer, and he learned these things. But in not examining ourselves, we give way to the devil. We give way to other people. We make it such that God has to examine us and chastise us, or that people in the church will need to come to us. But if we do it, again, which is what we should be doing, then we can beat them to the punch, right? Again, we don't want Satan and the world doing it, okay? Because if they do, then again, that's a smudge on the name of God. And then, again, God's going to do it. This is, you know, don't get me wrong that, you know, we're not going to be perfect and that we're not going to need God to work in our lives to show us these things. But again, we need to give him less to worry about us, okay? We need to be doing what we're told. Also, it's at this time of the year, and again, one of the reasons that we're even giving this message, is that we need it in order to take the Passover worthily. 1 Corinthians 11, verses 31 and 32. 1 Corinthians 11, verses 31 and 32. For if we would judge ourselves, we would not be judged. Make sense? In that context, you know, if you are correcting those things, then it's not going to come up. But when we are judged, we are chastened by the Lord, that we may not be condemned with the world. So, brethren, we should change, so that God doesn't have to get our attention. Okay, when you're a Christian and you give your lives to God, he is going to make sure that we change the way that we need to change and change the things that we need to change. So, wouldn't it be better? You know, again, any child can answer this question. You know, what's the nicer way? If you change, or if your parent has to then harp on you, correct you, discipline you to change? Again, sometimes that's the only way it's going to come, but nonetheless, you know, we still need to strive to do that. Back up to verse 27. Therefore, whoever eats this bread or drinks this cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of the body and blood of the Lord. Talking about Passover and how we are to approach Passover in a worthy manner. But let a man examine himself. All right? Test, prove, so that he can eat, and let him eat of the bread and drink of the cup. Again, we're to look at ourselves and say, okay, do I see Christ in me? We should be seeing those things. All right? But again, we can't fool ourselves and say, well, I'm falling short here. Right. We need to examine ourselves. And again, not just at this time of the year. This should be an ongoing basis. For he who eats and drinks in an unworthy manner eats and drinks judgment to himself, not discerning the Lord's body. For this reason, many are weak and sick among you, and many sleep. So again, there is a judgment that's brought down upon you if you do take the Passover in an unworthy manner. Okay? If you have not been doing these things to the best of your ability. Okay? No one's going to be perfect. Okay? And we will be convicted of our sins, our wrongs, our problems. That doesn't stop us, but we do need to be heading the right direction. We examine ourselves because we do have not only a responsibility to ourselves, but to those around us. You know, you might put Matthew 5, verses 14 through 16 in your notes. It's that we're to be a light of the world, the one that's put on a hill for all to see. And he says, let your light shine before men so that they can see your good works and glorify God in the process. So if, again, we are this light, we are going to be judged by the world. So we see that, and he's saying, okay, there's a necessity then for you to, you know, be before people in an unblemished way as much as possible. Ephesians 4:1. Again, this ties in with those 2 points, that we, one, take the Passover worthily, and that we also let our light shine. Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 1 says, therefore, the prisoner of the Lord beseech you to walk worthy of the calling with which you were called. So there is a way to walk. Those who are called of God are to walk in a worthy manner, okay, for all to see. And can you put Colossians 1:10, Philippians 1:27? Again, show that our conduct and our walk are to be worthy of Christ in us. All right, when people see us and they see the way that we act, okay, whoever that is, okay, when it's God or Satan, when it's the world or the church, when they see us, is that what they see? Do they see Christ in us by our good works, by the way that we walk? Are we walking in a manner that is worthy of that? In a manner that shows Christ in us, Christ working in us through his power. We are to examine ourselves then. 2 Corinthians 13, verse 5. Second Corinthians 13 and verse 5. It says, examine yourselves as to whether you are in the faith. All right? Are you, when you look at yourselves, are you showing this walk that is worthy of Christ? We need to examine that specific aspect. Test yourselves. Right? Do you not know yourselves that Jesus Christ is in you? Unless indeed you're disqualified. Unless you commit the unpardonable sin. You say, I don't want you in my life anymore. I'm going to show you that by my works and the way I walk. But no, we are to pyrazo. Okay? Test, try, examine that we are in. And again, the words here are talking about this assaying, this trying of metals, okay, by heat, by fire, to see if it is so. So we are to test it, to examine ourselves. And once we find out that, we're to prove the worth, our worth, by exemplifying it, okay? We are to live a way of life that is indicative of Christ in us, and a way of life that works, and we show that we're worthy by that. Romans 1 and verse 28. And even as they did not like to retain God, okay, that word retain, same word, okay, for test, prove. They did not test. They did not examine whether God was in their life. They never proved that. They didn't want to. All right? God gave them over to a debased mind. So because there was this lack of examination, a lack of seeing if they or we measure up to the Word of God, to Christ our example, if you're not going to do that, all right, then God's going to allow you to be given up to a debased mind, to do these things that are not fitting, right? And that what we were just talking about, you know, in 2 Corinthians 13:5, that unless you're disqualified, unless you allow these things to happen, unless you allow them to be, because you don't continue to examine yourself. So we see the seriousness then of the necessity to test ourselves, to examine ourselves. Chapter 2, verse 18. And know his will and approve. Again, the word for approve is the same word. Test, approve, test, or approve. Again, you can even see that in the underlying etymology of the word approve. And know his will and test the things that are excellent. Okay, so they should be there. These are things that you should be seeing in your life. Being instructed out of the law and are confident that you yourself are a guide to the blind and a light to those in darkness. Okay, you're that light on the hill. An instructor of the foolish, a teacher of babes, having the form of knowledge and the truth and the law. And you, therefore, who teach another, do you teach yourself? Are you studying? Are you learning these things? Are you examining them? Are you proving them to yourself? You who preach that a man should not steal, do you steal? You who say, do not commit adultery, do you commit adultery? You who abhor idols, do you rob temples? You who make your boast in the law, do you dishonor God through breaking the law? Do you practice what you preach? Do you say that you are a church member, but your acts and your works allow others to see differently? Will Satan take these things and be accusing you of them to God? Will the world look at you and say, you're no different? For the name of God is blasphemed among the Gentiles because of you, as it is written. What a horrible thing to have written of you. That, yeah, you guys were, you know, such poor representations of a Christian, that, yeah, the Gentiles looked at you and said, yeah, that's not a God I want to follow. That's not a God I want to be a part of. Chapter 12. Verses 1 and 2. I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, laying down your life, holy, acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service. And do not be conformed to this world. Don't do what they do. But be transformed by the renewing of your mind through the power of the Holy Spirit, that you may prove, right? Same word again. Through this examination, this testing, this trying, that you may prove what is the good and acceptable and perfect will of God. So whenever we look at our lives, he's saying, okay, am I doing what God says? Am I really, truly doing it to the extent that he wants me to be doing it? Again, we have to ask ourselves of the things that we're doing. Plus, we have to ask ourselves about the things that we're not doing. The things that we're doing wrong. It needs to be a thorough examination. This is done through Christ. Right? Philippians 4:13. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Right? And the converse is true, that without Christ these things cannot be done. John 15. Actually, let me just, you can write that in your notes, John 15 verses 4 through 8. Again, it's talking about abide in me and I in you. The branch cannot bear fruit unless it abides in the vine. Right? And then the end of verse 5, he says, for without me you can do nothing. This is Christ speaking. So go through and read that and see the necessity of having Christ in our lives as well. Of course, we also, through prayer, fasting, Bible study, meditation on the Word of God, you know, we can say to God, God, show me your ways through these things. The big four, right? Teach me your paths. And then, like Psalm 26, verse 2 says, examine me, O Lord, and prove me. Try my mind and my heart. This is what we're to be doing. This is what we're to be asking. Because it is not within man to even direct his own steps or to know the things of God without God working in him. And the last point under that is, don't use others as a guide. Again, when we judge others, we don't judge them as a comparison to ourselves. God gives to each as he wills. He calls whom he wants. He gives talents and abilities as he sees fit. He gives different gifts of the Spirit. And what's even worse about this aspect that you might even consider is that when Christ returns, he's going to separate the sheep and the goats. And there's a connotation that that's going on in the church. And if you're comparing yourself to a goat as a sheep, then you're going to think, oh, I'm doing great, when this person was not even on the track. Whether they're a goat or whether they're a Laodicean that's living the wrong life. In the very end, Revelation 3, verse 10, we look at this in terms of the end time eras of the church, the different attitudes that are extant at that time. Revelation 3 and verse 10. And of course, this is to the church at Philadelphia. It says, because, and this is Christ speaking, because you have kept my command to persevere, to keep on keeping on, to continue to do the things that you're supposed to do, I will also keep you from the hour of trial. And guess what that word is for trial? You know, it's perosmos, okay? The form of examination, which shall come upon the whole world. Okay, so those who go to the place of safety have already proven themselves. They've already examined themselves thoroughly, year after year after year. And God says, well done, my good and faithful servant. And you're allowed to go to the place of safety. But to the rest of the world, what does he say? He says, it's going to come upon the world to test. Again, the word parazo, to examine, all right, to prove, to try. Those who dwell on the earth, all those who remain, okay? Whether you are in the church, part of the Laodiceans, or not. There's coming a time of severe trial and tribulation, examination, that will come upon those who have not heeded the words that God has given to us. So we need to remember, Ecclesiastes 12:14 says, for God will bring every work into judgment, including every secret thing, whether good or evil. Right? So what's happening now? Who is examining you?